Hello and thank you everyone for attending today's webinar, Proven Technology for Smooth Motion and Harsh Environments, brought to you by Design World Magazine and Bishop-Wisecarver. I'm Mike Santora, Associate Editor for Design World Magazine, and I'll be your moderator. As always, we would like to thank our presenter, Brian Burke, for being here today. Brian Burke, Senior Product Manager at Bishop-Wisecarver Group, is passionate about product development and manufacturing with educational backgrounds in computer-aided drafting and design and manufacturing technology. He has more than 13 years of experience in the automation industry with extensive knowledge from the production floor operations to product marketing activities. Now, without further ado, here's Brian Burke.
Thank you for the introduction today, Mike, and a special thank you to Design World for hosting and promoting this webinar. And today we're going to talk about proven technology for smooth motion in harsh environments. But before we get into the topic, I'd like to give you a little background about myself. My name is Brian Burke, and I'm the product manager here at Bishop-Wisecarver. If you'd like to, you can reach out and connect to me on Twitter with my handle there. I'm also on LinkedIn, or you can email me directly at the email listed on the screen. So here's an overview agenda of what we will discuss today. Before we begin the topic, I'd like to give a brief overview about Bishop-Wisecarver Group and a range of our products for those of you who are not familiar with us. Before we get into the proven technology for smooth motion in harsh environments, and these products can be used in oven to freezer, washdown to vacuum, clean room to high debris. So these products are very diverse in their use. Mostly we're going to be talking about the dual beam motion technology and how these are component-based linear guides. We'll look at the product line and all the offerings in there, and we'll also look at how sizing and calculations are done to determine the load capacities and the expected life. Throughout, we'll look at several different application examples before examining one of our newer products, the vacuum wheel. The Bishop-Wisecarver Group is a certified women-owned business, and we have two subdivisions, including WRW Engineering and Black Diamond Manufacturing. With BDM, we do custom assemblies, machining services, and complex system builds. With WRW, we provide electrical engineering and complete automation solutions. But in general, the bulk of our products and systems go through Bishop-Wisecarver, which consists of linear and rotary motion products for industrial automation. We provide products and services to many different industries and applications, so you may see some overlap into your specific industry. Many of our products are used in packaging machinery and corrugate handling machines, as well as in paper and pulp production machinery. Our products also satisfy some higher accuracy requirements in testing and inspection, laser marking, and also in welding and pipe processing. So you can see that there's a wide range of usages for our automation products. With so many products for automation, it can be difficult to explain our range. So I like to use this image here, which we call the evolution. On the upper left-hand side, we have components and component-based products like our dual V guide wheels and the tracks in which they run on. These can be integrated into machines directly. Moving more towards the middle, we have sub-assemblies, like in our Low Pro and our Utilitrack. These are linear guides that are pre-assembled with guide wheels and track technology. Moving more to the upper right-hand corner is what we would call a system or a driven system or an actuator. These can be combined together into complete XYZ systems, and we have all the accessories available for gantry attachments, motor mounting, limit sensors, limit switches, gearbox, motors, drives, and controllers. Down on the bottom side, we have the HEPCO Motion products, and these are rings and ring and track systems. Same situation down there on the lower left-hand side. You can see the components where they're guide wheels and rings. Moving more towards the middle are sub-assemblies, such as rings and carriages and standard carriage assemblies. And over on the right-hand side, complete driven systems. You see the example of an oval system. That's a DTS, a driven track system. These are used in packaging environments and very high-speed automated assembly production lines. So you can see quite a range of products from individual components up to complete turnkey systems. Taking a closer look at the component side of the product offering, these products are very easy to understand, easy to install, and easy to adjust. They work very well in dirty environments or all environments, and they feature a self-cleaning design. They provide very smooth and quiet, low-friction motion. They can be high accuracy, high cycle, and high speed. They carry heavy-duty load capacities for durability and very long service life. And they come in a variety of different materials, including stainless steels, carbon steels, polymers, and aluminum. You can see an example picture down at the bottom of a guide wheel running on a track in an abrasive saw application where it's running in particulates there. Those particulates are very abrasive and sharp, and the guide wheel runs very well in this dirty application. So the core of the topic today is going to be focused on dual V motion technology, which is in fact the core of our business. It is our most popular product line. It's a component-based system of linear guides and guide wheels, which can be very flexibly attached to machine bases or machine frames for automation. There are several key advantages to these products. As I mentioned before, they're easy to understand, install, and adjust. And ground mounting surfaces are not required when installing these products, unlike some other common products such as profile rails. Now, these are ideal for very long travel lengths and for use in harsh environments. They provide very low noise and very low vibration when used. And they can function in a wide range of temperatures, from negative 94 degrees all the way up to 500 degrees Fahrenheit. So as a fairly high-level overview, this product line is a component-based system, and so it's made up of guide wheels and different ways of mounting those wheels, and then the linear track that it runs on. The guide wheels themselves are 90-degree double-row angular contact ball bearings, and you can see a cutaway image on the right-hand side showing the double rows. They come in different materials, carbon steel and stainless steel, and several different designs. In general, the through-hole is the most popular, but there are also studded designs where threads and hex features are permanently attached. The wheels can be mounted in a variety of methods, including bushings or journals, in two varieties, concentric fixed location versions and eccentric adjustable location versions. The linear track has a mating 90-degree surface, also in carbon steel and stainless steel, and these are available hardened or soft for prototyping. They can be drilled with holes or undrilled for processing at your factory. And then they are cut and polished on the running surfaces. So let's take a look at an application about how these components can be used to build up a machine. Now, this here is an automated welding device, and it's multi-axis built on dual V track, wheels, and bushings. You can see the machine base and the dual V track attached using bolts. This machine is two-axis, and it's used for the automated welding. So let's take a little bit of a closer look here. These products were developed out of frustration with recirculating ball bearing design, where material and debris would get into the balls and cause failure of the profile rail. These products have the balls sealed on the inside, and so they're protected from the outside debris. And then the wheel, as it rolls down the track, tends to eject the material, providing a self-cleaning design, which is ideal for harsh conditions. They can be very high speed, up to 5.5 meters per second, and also very high accelerations, up to 5 Gs. As we mentioned before, the end result is very smooth, low-friction motion. They can be high accuracy and highly repeatable. They provide a low total cost of ownership because it takes less labor to install the track on mounting surfaces. And the products are all high quality, and we stand behind our production quality methods with a 3-year limited warranty on the bearings. As the guide wheel rolls on the track, the 90-degree angles of the running surfaces create a constant sweeping action that clears debris away. This is suitable for use in the presence of metal chips, powders, fibers, sawdust, and other debris. You can see here a couple of application examples of these products being used in very dirty environments. Of course, we do recommend maintenance and cleaning periodically, as well as relubrication. We provide wheel covers and other lubricators, which can be used to wipe away some of the debris before the wheel contacts that area of the track. So if we want to talk about how this functions, if you imagine a close-up view of the wheel at the inner peak of the V, it's a fairly small diameter. Towards the outer edge of the wheel, it's a larger diameter. So with every rotation, the outer edge is moving a little bit faster than the inner edge. And so this causes what we call a velocity gradient, where it tends to be faster towards the edges and slower towards the peak of the track. And this helps to eject track and wipe it away from the track surface. So there are several different designs and sizes of the guide wheels themselves. You can see here in six different sizes, 0 up through 4XL. We initially created sizes 1, 2, 3, and 4, and when we went back to create a smaller wheel that was smaller than size 1, we had to make it a size 0. So if we come out with one that's even smaller, it'll probably be a double-aught wheel. Same thing going into the larger size when we created something larger than size 4. It didn't jump to size 5 because it runs on the same size 4 track, so it's a size 4XL. So these guide wheels are available in carbon steel, 52-100, and stainless steel in 440C. The size 4XL can have a load capacity all the way up to 3,215 pounds per bearing. So if you need to move 6,000 pounds, you would use two of these bearings, and you could accomplish that. There are several different versions of each size. And there's a high temperature version, a low temperature version, also a clean room compatible version, washdown wheel, and more recently available, a vacuum wheel. So the carbon wheel is 52-100 carbon steel that's heat treated and precision ground. It comes out at Rockwell C scale 60 to 62, which is very hard. The stainless version is 440C stainless steel, and it's hardened to Rockwell C 58 to 60. There are versions that can be used in temperatures up to 500 degrees. We have a unique seal shield configuration, which you won't find anywhere else on the market. And it's a steel shield with an NBR seal below it. And these are available in the middle range of sizes 2, 3, and 4. We'll take a closer look at this technology. Many of the leading causes of bearing failure are related to issues with the grease. Under extreme temperatures, the grease will become stiff in cold environments and will get thin or otherwise degrade in elevated temperatures. Over long service life, the internal grease will degrade. Therefore, the performance of the grease is a critical factor in the lifespan of a bearing. Another related issue is the ingress of foreign debris into the ball-to-ball race contact area where the grease is located. Any debris that makes it into the grease will cause premature problems. There are several different bearing designs to protect the inner workings of bearings. Many people are familiar with the seal and shield designs. The seal is a rubber technology which is best for small debris, particles, and powders. It has limited protection against impacts because it's rubber, it will deflect. It has a little bit more rolling resistance because the rubber actually touches the inner and outer race of the bearing, providing a very good seal for small particles. A shield is a metal technology, and it's usually made out of stainless steel. It's best for large debris such as metal chips or other big chunks. It provides good protection against impacts because it's metal and does not deflect easily. There is no additional resistance of the bearing with a shield because we don't want to have metal on metal contact. The metal shield stops short of the inner race. Dual B guide wheels have an innovative new seal technology in a seal shield. It's the best of both worlds. It's a rubber seal on the inside which contacts the inner race, providing a great seal against small particles. And on the outside, it has a metal shield which can protect against hot metal chips and other large impacts. If you're not sure about which design or grease you would like for your application, this chart is available from the main product line, and it shows several of the advantages as well as the different versions that are available. An example would be that the vacuum wheels, shown at about the middle level of the chart, of what the material composition of the product is and the temperature range. Now, this can be helpful when selecting a product for your application. If you have a high temperature application, like an oven, you can see that there at the lower section would be the SS227 wheel version, and that's available in all five wheel sizes from 1, 2, 3, and 4. Size 4XL, which is actually the largest bearing in the product line, is only available up in the carbon steel and stainless steel version near the top. Another useful chart from the product catalog is the dimensions. You can see here the range of products and the overall sizes. The size 0 is just over a half of an inch in diameter at 0.584, and the largest size 4XL is just under 3 inches at 2.968. They also list the tolerances for the bore diameter, but as we'll see in a few moments, the different ways of mounting the guide wheel, the bushings and the journals, are all fit to match based on the size. So if you pick a size 2 wheel, we have a size 2 bushing, and it will fit together. The only time that you would need to worry about the bore diameter is if you wanted to mount it in a custom fashion, such as on a pin or shoulder bolt. So for the guide wheels with a hole, the main way of mounting them is with a bushing. These are a low-cost solution, and they come in a variety of sizes. With these, you can affix the wheel to a mounting surface in a very precise fashion. They're all made out of 303 stainless steel for environmental compatibility. There's two different versions, a concentric version, which is fixed in the location you attach it, and an eccentric version, which has an adjustable center line. They're usually mounted in pairs with a concentric opposite of an eccentric, and they're used to do fit-up adjustment of the guide wheels to a parallel track. They come in a standard head height and a low-profile head height for more compact configurations. And additionally, there's two different versions, a metric unit version and an inch unit version. The other method for mounting guide wheels with a through hole is to use the journal assemblies. These assemblies integrate the bushing and fastener into a single piece. They also enable the eccentric adjustment from the opposite side of a mounting surface. This is useful when designs have limited access, such as a large plate or machine frame. They also come in concentric and eccentric versions and made of the same 303 stainless steel. They include the washers and the nuts, and there are versions for each size of guide wheel. Another version of wheel includes a threaded stud, which is permanently attached. These threaded studs are swaged to the wheel to make an assembly. It includes the mounting and adjustment hex. The stud material is also 303 stainless steel in the familiar concentric and eccentric versions. We can stud any guide wheel version from size 0 up through size 4, carbon steel or stainless steel, and all specialty versions, the low temperature, high temperature, washdown, and even the vacuum wheel. There are two versions of the studded guide wheel, the SWS series and the SWA series. The SWSs are studded and have a very compact thread section for short installations. The SWA series have a bit longer threaded section and a longer precision diameter for mounting into bores. These assemblies include the washer and the nut. The third type of studded wheel is the SWI series, and these are the polymer overmolded versions. They're available in the smaller sizes 1, 2, and 3, and are meant for light load applications and light duty cycles. They provide very smooth and quiet motion They are the main building block of our Utilitrack aluminum guides. The low-profile bushings and studded wheels have a very short installed height, and so a typical wrench will not fit. For these, we have thin wrenches that you can use for installation and adjustment. They're made from hardened 4310 carbon steel, and they're heat treated to Rockwell 46 to 56 with a convenient black oxide coating to resist corrosion. They're available for each standard size of product, and the 4XL size can use a standard wrench because it's large enough. Each wrench has an inch and metric opening, so they're compatible with each size of wheel. The guide wheels have double V angles, which can be used for running the wheel on a track surface or on any 90 degree surface. You can see here two examples of the guide wheel used on angle iron or a steel framing member. So on the left hand side, you can see the inner V of the wheel is running on the outside edge of angle iron. On the right hand side, the outer edge V of the wheel is running on the inside edge of angle iron. This can work for low precision applications such as machine doors and guarding or other adjustable features. If higher accuracies are needed, a more precise surface can be used, such as on machined angles or machined edges. So you can run the guide wheels on other surfaces like structural angled steel, but for typical installations, we recommend using the guide track. It's purposely designed for use with a guide wheel. These are very easy to install. They have an integrated mounting shoulder, which allows for accurate positioning of the V-ways. And you can install it with simple hand tools and common fasteners like bolts or screws. They can be ordered as formed, which is soft, or induction hardened. All versions are polished. Either undrilled without holes, or drilled with through holes. The undrilled version is for people who prefer to do their own machining or their own installations. But there are standard hole patterns and standard threads or standard through holes that are recommended and outlined. There are stainless steel versions and carbon steel versions. When they're hardened, they're 20 feet long, and when they're soft, they're 22 feet long. All versions can be butt joined together for unlimited travel lengths. So as I mentioned, the linear tracks come in two different materials, carbon steel and stainless steel. These materials differ from the guide wheels. In the carbon steel, it's AISI 1045, and it's hardened to about Rockwell C scale 53. In the soft version, as drawn, it's at Rockwell C 25. The stainless steel version is in 420 stainless, whereas the guide wheel was in 440 C. The hardened version gets up to 40 Rockwell C, and the soft version in stainless is at 22 Rockwell C. They're available in standard lengths with or without holes. An order can ship from the same day out of our inventory stock. We can easily accommodate custom lengths and custom hole drilling with short lead times. We can also supply finished options such as plating, electroless nickel, thin dense chrome, black oxide, paint, or any other type of additional coating or processing. Here's a view about how the tracks can be mounted. The underside has the mounting surface and the mounting shoulder. On the top image, you can see the track sitting on a support structure. It is recommended that that support structure be flat, straight, and parallel so that the V to V can be accurate and will provide a smooth running surface. The long track is actually quite flexible and will conform to the surface. And so it is important if you need accuracy to prepare those surfaces. So you can see on the top right hand image, the dual V track on a machined edge. It would be important to not only machine the top surface, but also the register for where the mounting shoulder will mount. This is not always necessary for lower accuracy requirements. For these, you can actually just mount the track on unmachined surfaces, typically mounting to hot rolled steel or other structural machine frames. At Bishop-Wisecarver, we always recommend lubrication for guide wheel technology. Lubrication is important for quite a few reasons. It reduces the friction, it resists corrosion, and it extends the usable life of a motion system. Lubrication is applied using lubricator assemblies, and there's a felt insert that's saturated with oil. This felt insert wipes away the debris on the guide track. It continuously dispenses the lubricant to increase the system life. There are standard and low-profile configurations for use with studded wheels and wheels mounted on bushings. These come in kits that include all of the necessary parts. There's a stamped stainless steel housing, the lubricator felt, mounting screws and washers, and a bottle of the recommended lubricant. We recommend a light oil as opposed to other lubricants because particulates and dirt do not tend to stick significantly in the light oil. Another type of wheel protection lubricator is the wheel cover. These are used when it's necessary to reduce pinch points and protect the wheel to the track interface. These also wipe away debris before the guide wheel can roll over the debris on the track. These continuously dispense the lubrication as well because they include two oil-saturated felts. These also come in the standard head height and the low-profile head height, available in a kit with all the necessary parts to cover one wheel. One of the typical installation designs is what we would call inboard mounting. This is a case where we use the V's in between two guide wheels. You can see the top mounting surface and what we would call the carriage plate where the tracks are attached. Either surface can be stationary while the other moves. So we would typically have an eccentric bushing, such as on the right-hand side, which is adjustable, opposite of a concentric bushing on the left-hand side. Using the eccentric, you can adjust the fit-up to the carriage plate and have zero play and provide very smooth motion without any vibration. Let's take a look at an application example using inboard mounting. In this case, we're looking at a packaging machine. This machine does the shrink wrapping and palletizing and case packing of finished products. So let's take a closer look at the machine. There are many different axes on this machine, all based off of the dual V guide wheels. You can see the orange arrows pointing to the guide wheels and the linear tracks that they run on. In this case, the dual V track is mounted to structural steel frames that have threaded holes and in the long linear pattern. There are many different axes in this machine, and the end result is that the products go in one side and come out completely packaged and shrink-wrapped on the other end. A second type of typical mounting is what we would call outboard. In this case, the tracks run on the opposite edges of the wheels on the outside, and the wheels are mounted to the inside. It's a very similar configuration, and you can see that the top mounting surface and the carriage plate, either of those could move. In the same fashion, it both uses the eccentric bushing and the concentric bushing design to take up any play in the installation. So here's an application example of the outboard mounting. This one is a food packaging machine, and in this case, it's a melon cutting machine that travels quite a lot of distance, approximately 180,000 inches per day in a washdown food grade environment. You can see the guide wheels are running on a guillotine structure, which is driven by a large motor. On the outboard installation can be seen on the right-hand side, where the tracks are mounted on the exterior V's of the carriage assembly. So here's a look at the wheel configurations from side by side. Over on the left-hand image, you can see the outboard mounting, and over on the right-hand side, you can see the inboard mounting. Take note of the load direction. It's important that the load is only supported by the concentric bearing. You do not want to make an installation where the load is supported on the eccentric bearing because the mass can work against the cam in the bearing and cause the adjustment to come free. So please be mindful of the load direction when you install the bushings or journals. Okay, so let's take a look at the steps involved in calculating the bearing load capacity and also the life estimate. There's many different sizes of guide wheels and different load capacities, and so there is a standardized procedure in place for selecting an appropriate product for your application. The sizing and life estimation is done in three simple steps. Step one is to calculate the load on each bearing in the system. Step two, calculate the load factor for the most heavily loaded wheel. And then step three, calculate the life estimate using the equation. It's important to note that the values provided by Bishop-Wisecarver are for working load capacities. These are based on empirical data and the guide wheels, and they're used in general applications with static and dynamic loading conditions. Guide wheels can routinely achieve travel life of 1 million cycles or higher when these specified load capacities are observed. There are many different factors to consider when designing and sizing a motion system. Some of these factors, if they're very large, will greatly impact the usable life of a system. So please keep in mind these issues: the orientations and directions, the loads, the velocity. A high velocity system may have a lower life. High accelerations could impact that as well. The duty cycle. The presence of high shock or vibrations will also impact the life. So let's take a look at how we do wheel sizing. Step one, as we mentioned before, is calculate the loads on each bearing in the system. It's important to be mindful of loading conditions in every direction. You can see here some three sample scenarios of common installation methods. We're going to do a sample calculation based on scenario number three. Assuming we have a 200-pound load at the end of the shaft with known distance of 15 inches to the Vs, and the wheels are spaced at 5 inches apart. We can calculate out the axial and radial loads component to be 200 pounds or 100 pounds per guide wheel. This is assuming a typical installation of 4 guide wheels, but the image only shows the end view. So now we move on to step two, calculate the load factor for the most heavily loaded bearing. As an example, we'll use the W4X wheel using the FA max and the FR max from the chart. So you can see here the equation down at the bottom is LF equals FA over FA max plus FR over FR max. This is essentially a ratio. It's the axial force over the max axial force plus the radial force over the max radial force. In this situation, where we're looking at the W4X and the 100-pound load, we calculate out to having 0.38 or 38% of that guide wheel's capacity. Next, we calculate the life estimate of that loading situation on that wheel size. So we use the life equation here. In the previous slide, we calculated the LF, and here we have the LC, or the life constant. You can see here the standard life in distance of travel. So in this case, on the size W4 wheel, we get the 6.84 times 10 to the 6th for inches of travel, divided by the load factor that we calculated before, 0.38 cubed. And then we have an adjustment factor here, times 1.0. This adjustment factor is what we use to derate a system. So if it's very clean, very smooth, there's no shock, no vibration, normal temperature, it would be considered low, or an adjustment factor of 1.0. If it's very dirty, or there's a lot of shock, or there's no lubrication, we would move higher up the scale to medium or even high. So this is a derating factor, which can have a huge engineering safety factor applied to the system. So in this case, we're going to assume it's a very clean, well-lubricated system. We're going to use an adjustment factor of 1.0. This results in a calculation of 124.7 times 10 to the 6 inches of travel. That's what we estimate this bearing system is likely to achieve in total distance of travel. The next step, which is completely optional, would be to calculate that times the duty cycle. That would be how quickly you would consume those inches of travel. If you're moving this only once or twice a day, it could take quite a long time. If you're moving very rapidly, 24/7 hours a day, you could get there very quickly. So this is essentially the life estimate, and the end user is to decide if that's acceptable in their application. Here's another application of Dual V in a harsh environment. This one is pipe cutting and beveling equipment. The guide wheels are used to guide a torch to prepare pipes for joining. This is used in the field out where the work is to be done, outside and outdoors. You can see that the guide wheel is used to guide the torch while the pipe is rotated. There are a few special versions of the guide wheel, including the high temperature, low temperature, and washdown wheels. Today we're going to take a look at the vacuum wheel version. As we mentioned before, the grease is a very important factor in the guide wheel, and in the case of the vacuum wheel, we're using a special ultra-high vacuum grease, the Ultratherm 2000. These guide wheels are the identical shape and quality as the other wheels. They're only available in two sizes, in the size 1 and 2, and they're made up of the stainless version, which is typically necessary in vacuum applications. They are compatible and recommended for use with the stainless bushings and the stainless tracks. There are many different applications involving vacuum environments. They're located in high technology applications such as art research and development, in material sciences, semiconductor and electronic fabrication, in high altitude testing and simulation, and also in space testing and simulation. There's other applications in life sciences and pharmaceuticals, maybe in encapsulating and pill production. There's also filling and dosing. It could be used in packaging or leak testing, and also in degassing of materials for processing. Whenever you put a product into a vacuum chamber environment, it's important to know all of the materials in construction that make up that product. So in the case of the vacuum wheels, the inner race, the outer race, and the balls are all 440 stainless. The ball cage and shield is 304 stainless. And the grease is a special vacuum grease, the Ultratherm 2000. In many vacuum applications, there's a special bakeout process at the beginning to ensure that any volatile compounds are burned off before the continuous operation. In this case, the guide wheels can be exposed to negative 35 degrees centigrade up to 250 degrees centigrade intermittently for short periods. Then it's rated for suitable use at 150 degrees C. So let's take a look at the special grease, because it is an important part in determining whether this product is suitable for vacuum application. The grease is from a manufacturer, Lubecon, and it's Lubecon Ultratherm 2000. And you can see here the vapor pressure and the temperature chart. So if it's needed to be used in a bakeout process, you want to make sure that the grease will not outgas at that elevated temperature. But in general, it's a very low outgassing grease, and you can see the ratings there at the top. So let's take a look at some of the applications in vacuum environments where these would be a suitable product. Here's two examples from space simulation and testing chambers. Many times a satellite or control package needs to be tested, and it's put into a vacuum chamber. Sometimes these can be very large, and chambers are fitted with slide-out racks or equipment racks within the chamber. This is useful for loading and unloading expensive or complex packages. Compare that to the image on the right, where a dolly or mobile cart is used to load a device into the chamber for testing. So it is important not to damage your test subject in handling it in and out of a test chamber. Another example of where these can be used is in load lock applications. A load lock typically will load a wafer or substrate into a process chamber. There are manual load locks and automated load locks. Essentially, a substrate is loaded into the chamber, and the chamber is pumped down to the same vacuum environment as the processing chamber before the load lock door is opened and the substrate inserted. And so sometimes it's a long reach and needs to be automated. For these applications, the vacuum guide wheel will be ideal. Okay, so today we took a look at dual V guide wheels and how they are a proven technology for smooth motion in harsh environments. We see how they are ideal for many different applications. They're very easy to understand, easy to assemble, and easy to adjust. They're a component-based system, what we like to call an industrial erector set or Lego kit. They're ideal for very long lengths, and they work well in harsh and debris-laden environments due to their constant sweeping action as they run. They're capable of very high load capacities, up to 3,215 pounds per bearing in the size 4XL, and they can have very compact installation heights. If you have any questions about these products or how we did the life and sizing calculations, please contact our customer service department and our application engineers. They're available more than 10 hours each day to answer all of your questions and provide product support. So this covers the bulk of our webinar topic today. I would like to thank again Design World Magazine and Mike Santora, our host. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being so patient. What we are going to do now is we are going to open it up for questions for Brian. The first one is about any welding applications. Brian?
Yes, these products are commonly used in welding applications, and we did go over a few examples there. It is important to protect them from weld splatter directly. Molten metal may actually stick. And so, yes, welding equipment is a very common application.
So I want to move on to the next question here. What would a vacuum wheel be used for?
Yes, vacuum wheels are used in many different applications. There are sometimes you need to process materials like powders or other polymers to ensure that there's no bubbles. So it's used for outgassing to ensure proper curing, things like that. But it can also be used in environmental test chambers where there are, you know, low atmosphere environments.
Okay, and what about, I think that's supposed to be wet environments.
You can use the products in wet environments, and in fact, there is a washdown wheel version. It's made out of the 440 stainless steel, and it has a special double steel design, which protects the internal grease from high pressure washdown, and so those applications are possible.
So moving along here, Brian, we have what is the main difference between the eccentric and concentric wheel?
Sure, that's a great question. The concentric wheel is mounted all on center line, and it's meant to be located in a fixed position. It's not adjustable in any way. It's essentially the reference plane. When you mount two together, it creates a line, and that's a reference plane. The eccentric is actually lobed like a cam, and so it's offset. In the case of a bushing, it has an offset hole, and in the case of a journal, it has an offset stud. And so with that, when you mount that into a hole, you can adjust it tighter or looser, basically camming it closer or further away from the concentric bushing. And so with that arrangement, you can adjust up to zero play and have a very good fit and very smooth motion to your linear rail.
Okay, well, thank you so very much, Brian, for all the great information. We certainly appreciate it. I just want to send out a reminder to everybody that has tuned in that this webinar will be available at designworldonline.com and, of course, by email. You can also tweet with the hashtag, #DWWebinar, for anybody that wants to connect through your favorite social media platforms, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, and such. You can do that as well. And, of course, you can also discuss this on engineeringexchange.com. And lastly, of course, we want to thank you on behalf of Design World for tuning into this webinar.